U.S. President Joe Biden admits delivering a poor performance in his much-anticipated face-off with Republican rival Donald Trump. The two candidates held their first presidential debate Thursday, where Biden gave shaky answers that caused concerns for the Democratic Party. But Biden allays the growing worries, insisting he would not be running for re-election if he couldn't handle the job.
Folks, let me close with this. I know I'm not a young man. State the obvious. Well, I know. Well, I don't. Folks, I don't walk as easy as I used to. I don't speak as smoothly as I used to. I don't debate as well as I used to. But I know what I do know. I know how to tell the truth. I know right from wrong. And I know how to do this job. I know how to get things done. And I know, like millions of Americans know, when you get knocked down, you get back up.
Now, Trump is asserting Biden's debate performance is a loss for the Democrats.
Despite the fact that crooked Joe Biden spent the entire week at Camp David resting, working, studying. He studied very hard. He studied so hard that he didn't know what the hell he was doing. He was never very good, but now he's really not good. Last night was a defeat not only for Biden, but for the entire radical left Democrat Party and the fake news media, who have been lying to the American people as our country was being destroyed.
The debate performance of both presidential candidates also sparked panic among their supporters. Our North America correspondent Len Almaden Thornhill has the story.
The first debate between President Joe Biden and former President Donald Trump, a historic and most anticipated event of this year's U.S. presidential election, exposed weaknesses in both candidates. Their performance Thursday night, sparking panic and concern within both campaigns and with voters, including with some Filipino Americans.
Just to see like two older white men that are octogenarians, essentially way older, that are basically going to be, one of them are probably going to be our president. Isn't it like reflective of me as like a young voter? And so there is some kind of fear that comes in that, because you're not really sure about, you know, the fitness of either candidate.
Tiffany Garnasi, a Democrat, is not the only one apprehensive.
I do worry about that they've got to be on their A game. It's only June, almost July, and they've got till November, and then they've still got the next 4 years. And so how sharp will they be? And will they be able to really like stand up and defend our country? They're the commander in chief. How will they be able to both really do that?
Like many voters, Republican Beatrice Taraba Shackle is still weighing her options.
I stand behind my party, and I saw when former President Trump was president, the good that he did economically. But I personally, as a person, as an individual, I don't feel the most comfortable, you know, just him leading and his, I guess, his attitudes and character traits, especially being a woman and being a minority, that kind of turns me off.
YouGov poll shows that Trump won the debate, but independent voter Genevieve Santiago, a New Hampshire resident, is leaning towards voting for Biden despite his shaky performance.
I was a little disappointed on both sides. I was upset that Biden really showed his age. I thought this was a really good time for him to show, like, he's confident, he has power, and he understands what's going on. He had a couple fumbles, but I think he did all right overall.
Santiago says, like many independent voters, she could be convinced to vote for Trump. According to a 2020 presidential election exit poll, 54% of independent voters chose Biden, while 41% voted for Trump.
If Trump presented an actual plan and was a little less negative about everything and started talking about how he was going to get us out of whatever issues he believes that we're suffering with right now, then maybe I could back him.
Polls leading to the debate repeatedly indicate that Trump and Biden are virtually neck and neck, particularly in battleground states like Georgia.
It's like I'm choosing basically the lesser of two evils, essentially. And that's like kind of how like a lot of people feel right now.
Both Biden and Trump hit the campaign trail Friday after facing off in their first presidential debate. Trump rallying his supporters in Virginia, a state he lost to Biden in 2020, and Biden in North Carolina, giving reassurance to supporters that he could still do the job. Lenamton Thornhill, ABS-CBN News, Atlanta, Georgia.
Retired two-time NBA All-Star Joakim Noah visits the Philippines to participate in a global initiative to give abandoned basketball courts a new lease on life. Our very own Migs Bustos sat down with the great hoops player about what this means for him.
I know it's your first time here. Can you tell us more about your experience so far? What's it like being in this Philippine basketball culture?
Well, honestly, it's an honor to be here. This is my first time in Manila. It was a long, long flight to get here. I missed my connection. It took me 30 hours. But I got here, and the first thing, I couldn't believe how many people in the airport were saying, oh, Chicago Bulls. And
lots of Bulls fans here.
Lots of Bulls fans. I felt that right away. And to me, it was just, it was beautiful to see. You know, I haven't played in the Chicago Bulls in like 10 years.
Yeah.
And people knew and were very nice to me right away, and it's really been an honor to be here.
Yes, of course. Well, just to off that excerpt, your run in the Bulls with Derrick Rose and all that great run, many people resonated with that just because you had a great run. People or make that Filipinos, we relate to grit, and that's what you are about. So can you tell us more what it's like? I know you have your dad, your grandfather also being professional players, but can you take us through your character as a professional athlete?
You know, I think that I was raised in sports. You know, my grandfather, I'm a third generation athlete. My grandfather was a soccer player. You know, my father was a tennis player from Cameroon. You know, so, you know, I saw that the way that they practiced every day and the way they worked, and I think that it definitely helped me. But I think that one of the reasons why it resonated over here also was playing with the most humble superstar ever in Derrick Rose. I know that Derrick had come here. I remember when we played on the Bulls, he had told me that he had come to Manila before with Kobe. So I think that just his humility as a player was something that also resonated. I felt like people really liked him over here.
When you talk about Philippine basketball, and I know they'll be here for the next few days, you'll see a lot of kids just wanting to dream. I know you've seen some photos or maybe on social media, just court swapping out everywhere without even proper footwear, right? And that's the culture that it brings. How important is that for you, you know? Just that resilience and just, you know, I'll do everything what it takes for me to reach my dreams.
Well, I think that's a beautiful thing, and everybody has a story to tell. And you have to, it's all about the resilience, you know. I think that when you come from that, you know, not having the proper infrastructure and stuff like that, it makes you want it more. And you have to show a fighting spirit, and that's what it's all about. And I think that building courts like this, it makes you want to, you know, you know that you have a beautiful court and you want to do more.
Now, if you can share one particular story, you know, about Joakim Noah's challenges and trials, what is that, and what is that one thing that you want to impart to the Filipino audience?
You know, I think everybody has a different story. You know, my father is from Cameroon also. He's the last French person to win a Grand Slam, but also the only African to win a Grand Slam. And I always take that to heart, that, you know, this is bigger than any sports. It's about being able to give back for me, it was, you know, my father was probably one of the most famous people in the country, in France, and being able to get out of his shadow and build my own name. And that's something that not a lot of people can resonate with, because I was a privileged kid, but I wanted to have my own name, and I think I was able to do that as an athlete.
Lastly, Joakim, growing up in New York, that's the mecca of basketball, and basketball courts bring people together, as you mentioned a while ago. Does this kind of resonate some, a little bit of a New York vibe? And when you see or experience that same feeling, how special is that for you?
Well, I think it's very important, you know, and wherever you go in the world, the culture is going to be different. For example, you know, New York street ball is a big part of our culture. We have playgrounds everywhere. Yeah. But then you go to Chicago and there's no playgrounds because there's too much violence. So everywhere you go is different. I think that street ball is something that's very important. It's being able to bring community together, you know, enjoy the games, but also in a place where you can bring your family, your friends, they can watch you play, kids can come and watch you play. I think that these are all really big building blocks in community, and that's what these courts represent.
Well, lastly, Joakim, if you could give a message or two to our Filipino fans, what would that be?
To all the Filipino fans out here, I just want to show you some love. This is Joakim Noah. Aim high, work hard, enjoy the court, and I hope you guys are just enjoying basketball. Peace.
The epitome of grit and resilience, it shows in his game. Joakim Noah, thank you so much for joining us here on ABS-CBN. Thank you, Joakim.